Dit is my so lekker om vanoggend met Dr. Abongile Balagane te gesels. Nou, ons praat 'n bietjie oor die hoogs patogeen influenza en dis eintlik maar voelgriep. Dr. Welcome to Grootplaas.
Morning everyone and thank you for this opportunity.
We really appreciate your time this morning. Dr. Tell us why there were shortages of eggs last year here in South Africa. What caused that?
I must say 2023 was one of the most devastating years in the egg industry. Globally, we've seen this avian influenza started in the Northern Hemisphere. Fortunately, it came down also to South Africa. If I take you a step back about the history of this disease or bird flu, in 2017, we had our first avian influenza in South Africa. Mm. It followed another trend in 2021. But what we've seen in 2023, I must say it was the worst that we have seen before. We lost about 30% of the industry on the layer side, which affected your production of your daily eggs and also on the breeding side. Mm. What really surprised us in 2023, usually we have a strain called the H5 in South Africa. Mm. But in 2023, we saw a new strain, you know, a birth of a new strain called the H7. That is the H7 that really frustrated the industry or destroyed the egg industry last year. Mm. I mean, under normal circumstances, we have about 27 million layer chickens that gives us eggs on a daily basis. Out of that 27 million, we can say 9 million was actually destroyed, culled, because of both the H5 and the H7, which then ultimately resulted in the shortages of eggs in the country. We've seen then, of course, the supply and demand forces taking place in terms of driving the prices in the trade. Fortunately, because we're one of the countries that is very quick, to sort of pick up, from the disasters. Mm. What we then did late last year as the industry, we reduced on our export program in terms of exporting your shell eggs, your fresh eggs. So we then imported a lot of powder and liquid just to substitute, the deficit. Then all the eggs that were remaining in the system, we then channel those eggs back to the consumers or the retailers.
Yes. So, Doctor, now that the industry has lost about 30% of the normal national production due to the bird flu, when and how long do you think it's going to take for the industry to return back to normal? And here I say normal to whatever normal looks like. And what does that normal look like?
Normal is when we have about 27 million chickens giving us eggs on a daily basis. At this stage, we've got about, below 20 million, roughly around 18 to 19 million birds at this stage. Now, yeah. if you start everything from scratch now, meaning starting from, your hatcheries all the way up to a point of lay, but for that part of the value chain alone, you're looking at anything around 17 months at most.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of work started late last year from the breeder side. Late last year, I did indicate to the South African consumers during the time when I was doing a number of interviews that it will take us, the 17 months to return to normal. At this stage, I would say confidently, I see in terms of the point of lays that are coming now, new chickens that are coming into the system, the day-old chicks that are being hatched at this stage. Mm. In my estimations, I foresee us getting back to normal as early as in the first half of 2025. Now, anytime between March and June next year, we should be back to the 27 million birds that we have.
That is wonderful news. I'm thinking now, has government stepped in to help the farmers who were affected by this bird flu?
The definition of this bird flu, it's normally classified as a controlled disease under the Department of Agriculture or the new Department of Agriculture. But then says it's that once you suspect it as a farmer in your farm operation, you immediately report that to a state vet. Now, the state vet will be more like of a co-pilot, will take over of the operation in terms of placing the farm on quarantine, ensuring there's no movement of birds, movement of eggs. Mm. And ultimately, a decision will be made if you have tested positive as a producer for this disease. A decision will be made by government, which entails that you need to cull or destroy those birds and those eggs, yeah. the feed, the packaging material. And then there is a clause, you know, in terms of the law that speaks about compensation for the farmers who have been affected by the avian influenza. Unfortunately, to this date, in terms of our records, there's none of the farmers that have been compensated from this previous avian influenza. Late last year, around October, November, we had the Deputy President, Mr. Paul Mashatile, stating publicly that there will be some assistance, you know, to the poultry industry of a value of about 3 billion rands. In terms of our cost estimate, you know, in terms of the damages of this avian influenza, we're estimating anything around 1.5 to 2 billion rands on the layer side. Of course, also the broiler industry was affected by this disease. The 3 billion rand that was indicated by the deputy president, actually, it would have boosted the industry to get back to normal. Where we are at this stage, it is a high desperation from those producers that are affected in terms of accessing the finance, even from the commercial banks. Mm. It is difficult for those producers to access the funding. Mm. So in a nutshell, we are still waiting, you know, for the government to rescue the situation as much as, you know, we want to see the industry going back on track. So ultimately, it all goes back to access to finance at this stage.
Absolutely.
Yes, that's where we are.
So you are the CEO of the SAPA Egg Organization, and we hear that there has been some talks between SAPA and government on vaccines for bird flu. How far are these discussions, if they are happening?
So during the times of the disaster, you know, late last year, we embarked on a process of discussing or negotiating with government the possibility to vaccinate for this disease, similarly to the vaccine that we also use for other diseases like your Newcastle. So because we had the two strains in the country, the H5 and the H7, we were successful in terms of, you know, our discussions with government to register and approve the H5 vaccines. Mm. We do have those vaccines now available for use in South Africa. However, the H7 vaccines are still under, let's say, the test, the trials and all that are not yet approved. Now, over and above that, what came positive in terms of our discussions with government, we now have the protocols to vaccinate now, meaning the license, you know, to use the vaccines as a producer, or the guideline, you know, for you to comply with when you apply for the vaccines.
Yes.
Unfortunately, we have the vaccines available, but the guidelines, or let's say the protocols, are actually difficult to implement at this stage for the producers. And they are, I mean, also issues of cost, they are highly expensive to implement. So where we are as the association and government, we are still trying to negotiate at least a flexible version of those protocols so that at least they become inclusive and everyone can have access, you know, to vaccinate. We don't want to see a situation where they are actually excluding certain producers, or let's call it the smallholder farmers. You know, we wish to see everyone having access to these vaccines and everyone treated equally, because this avian influenza, it doesn't say smallholder or commercial farmer. When it comes, it wipes out everything. It destroys everyone.
Yeah. So tell me, it is absolutely devastating. And I'm just glad to hear that there are discussions taking place. If we can move on from the bird flu, which is it's going to be an ongoing topic, but we also recently saw an online petition against the egg industry on a drive for cage-free and National Agricultural Marketing Council research. Can you tell me a little bit about me as a consumer? Tell me a bit about this research. What does it entail?
Thanks, sir. Now, let me give you a picture of what is happening globally. If you look globally, in let's say the first world countries have embarked on a process, you know, decisions to move from the, you know, your traditional cage systems to your free range systems. That drive also, we've seen it in countries like America, your European countries. Now, that drive also landed in South Africa. Of course, as South Africa, we are a member of the international egg community. We're not isolated from the rest of the world. Now, what is happening in those first worlds, unfortunately, it may not fit, you know, in South Africa. It cannot be one size fits all. Now, the picture globally, probably about 60% of the global eggs are produced by the BRICS countries. Unfortunately, South Africa is part of the BRICS countries. Now, out of that 60%, if you have to split now, how many, you know, percentage-wise, how much is produced under the cages?
Yeah.
I would say within the BRICS countries, probably 90% of the eggs are still, you know, produced under your cage systems, and then you've got about 4% on your free range, and then your 1% on the barn systems. Same situation you'll get in South Africa. We've got about 94% of our production still under the cages. And then over and above that, there's a 4% on free range and 1% on barn systems. Now, the free range product, it's more of your premium product in terms of the price wise. I don't want to mention the stores, but if you go to the stores that sell free range eggs, you'll see the difference in, you know, with the stores that don't have the free range or don't supply supply the free range product. So as a consumer, you can easily see the price, you know, you pay for a free range and a cage produced egg. Now what we did as the association some years back, we commissioned a research through the National Agricultural Marketing Council. We've said to the NAMC, please assist us, conduct a research as government that can show us if we were to consider go the same route as your first world countries, you know, move everything to cage-free systems. How long or how much will that cost, and you know, the time frames, what will the impact of that transition? The research from the National Agricultural Marketing Council proved or showed that about 36% of the industry will decline, meaning that 36 of our production will go out if you go cage-free. It will require some financial muscle of about 5 billion rands. Now, remember, this study was done about 4 years ago. Now, that price probably has now increased. Now, it also indicated that the prices of eggs will increase by 26%. In a country like South Africa, where you speak of, you know, your smallholder farmers, your transformation issues, if you are likely to reduce or have the industry shrinking by 36%, where are you going to sort of cater for transformation? In the same country where you've got your high unemployment rate, your poverty, high poverty levels, we know the situation of the country. If eggs, which is one of the most affordable animal protein sources, becomes expensive, what are you saying to issues of food security? Unfortunately, our position does not favor the welfare people, or let's call them the welfare lobbyists. So there are a number of the welfare groupings that are going online, you know, running some petitions against the industry, trying to access this NAMC study. Yeah. The NAMC study, it belongs to SAPA. It's a let's say, property of IP of SAPA. However, we are willing to share it with the people that are making the decisions or policymakers. They have the study. The people who participated in the study, we shared with the consumers, we shared with the retailers, with the producers. However, the welfare were not part of the study. So that is the battle we are having with the welfare people, not understanding where we're coming from. And I must say and emphasize that we're not against the cage-free systems or the free range.
I think we definitely need to have another discussion also about this, because the topic is so big, but we've unfortunately run out of time. I really appreciate your time this morning. Thank you so much.
Baie dankie, Dr.
Baie dankie.